Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Love Spells Trouble by Nova Nelson, narrated by Rebecca Mitchell. Chapter 1. Something was different about Tanner, and I wasn't complaining. I stared at him across our table for two, trying to put my finger on it. Were the winds of change behind this? Was it a third of a life crisis as he approached 30? Or was it his new job as deputy that had helped bring out a confident and decisive side of him, one that wouldn't have been especially useful in a setting like medium rare? Actually, who gave a shift why? I sure didn't. So long as he kept me around, I was ready to roll with it.
"If it turns out she's not any good, just don't hire her," Tanner said, skewering a tomato in his dinner salad at Stew and Brew. "You're the boss now, Nora. The decision's yours."
"You're still co-owner," I said, pausing a moment from blowing on my tomato basil bisque. "And I guess I just don't want to get a reputation of being a hard-to-please boss." Tanner paused in his chewing, then stuffed his mouthful into his cheek, so he could say,
"I happen to like that you're hard to please. And besides, who cares if people think that about you?"
I tilted my head to the side. "Quick question. Are body snatchers a thing here?" Tanner frowned and shook his head.
"Not anymore. Witches killed them pretty much right off the bat when they came to Eastwind."
I narrowed my eyes at him. "You sure? I think they might have missed one, because the Tanner I know has gone missing." He rolled his eyes playfully. "You got a lot of nerve telling me not to care about what people think when I've been viewed as a harbinger of death since day one, and you," I jabbed my spoon in his direction, "are everyone's favorite witch."
"Were," he corrected. "Past tense. Amazing how quickly things can change when one tries to protect and serve."
I chuckled. "Sounds like quite the crash course for a people pleaser like you." Tanner nodded, a sly grin spreading across his face.
"I wouldn't trade it for the world."
"Neither would I." While it was nice to have a date night with my boyfriend, I'd asked him out for a specific reason. We'd made it through the Donovan, let's call it a hitch. And now it was time to clear the air once and for all. It was time to tell Tanner about Roland. Why had I finally chosen tonight? Two reasons. First, it was a totally unremarkable day to do it. I didn't want to wait until I was at a crisis point. Things were going pretty well with us. No, very well. And every day that passed without telling him there was a past life lover ghost crashing in my bedroom was another splinter of hurt he might feel when he finally found out. And second, he was finally through the roughest part of his on-the-job training, and telling him wouldn't risk launching him into a major breakdown. Yes, he might have loved the job, but I'd never seen him so tightly wound as he was before it each day, and so exhausted as he was when he got off his shift. That was the reason I'd waited almost a month after getting back together with him to come clean about this minor detail. No, really, that's it. I was just being a good girlfriend. Was I worried he would break up with me all over again? Just a little. At the same time, though, I couldn't see Tanner giving up for good what we had, and the Roland thing was mostly not my fault. Yes, I said mostly. I accept some responsibility for, you know, pulling him through from another plane or whatever, and allowing him to haunt my bedroom without banishing him. I just hadn't decided what to do about him yet. On the one hand, I was happy with Tanner, more than happy. I was crazy in love. Roland was all but irrelevant now. On the other hand, Roland had traveled through lifetimes to be with me again, and I hadn't yet given him that second chance. To banish him would be a forever thing, I was sure. I wasn't ready to pull the trigger on that, and he'd said himself he would wait for as long as he had to. Had I considered the possibility of letting him wait until Tanner and I both died, and then giving it a shot with him in another life? Of course I had. Who wouldn't want to know a love as dedicated as Roland's was waiting for them in their next life?
Sure, I couldn't necessarily trust his motives in this lifetime, since his desire conflicted with mine. But I did know down to my bones that he loved me in his strange, obsessive way. And everything he did because he thought it was what I truly wanted. It was slightly obnoxious that he didn't trust me when I told him what I truly wanted. But then again, sometimes I wasn't so sure of it myself. Maybe he did know what I wanted at a core level better than I did. I didn't think so, though. Tanner, there's something I need to tell you, and I need you to know that I'm handling it the best I can, but it's complicated and messy, and it might hurt you to hear about it. He set down his fork carefully and dabbed at his mouth with a napkin before looking me in the eyes. His posture was rigid, and I could practically feel tension radiating off of him.
Is it something new with Donovan?
Huh? Oh, no, not him. His chest expanded quickly as he began breathing again.
That's good. But you said not him. Does that mean there's someone else?
It's someone from a past life, I said. Then the rest tumbled out in an avalanche. He was tracking me through multiple lifetimes, and now he's here in spirit form, and I could banish him, and I feel bad. I don't know what to do, and I've been sitting on this for a while, and... He held up a hand to stop me. Slow down. He looked more amused than angry, and I would take it, even if that amusement was derived from my misery.
You have a ghost from a past life hovering around you?
I nodded.
Is he here now?
No. He grabbed his fork again and stabbed his salad.
Okay, then. I'm not threatened by a ghost.
He wants me to find a way to give him his body back. Tanner paused and set down his fork again.
Well, are you going to do that?
I promised him I would, but I was sort of brainwashed at the time. Now I'm not sure. Yes, I made a promise, but I don't necessarily want to keep it. Dimples appeared on Tanner's cheeks as he repressed a grin.
Nora, I know your life didn't start the minute you met me.
But it kinda did, I said. He smiled.
What I mean is, you're allowed to have past loves. And if they can't seem to get over you, well, I don't blame them. I'd probably track you through lifetimes, too, if I had the faintest clue how that was possible.
He reached out and placed a hand over mine.
I can tell this has been bothering you. How about we make a deal?
A deal? This was not how I'd envisioned this going. The old Tanner had flipped out when I'd told him about Donovan, and now this new version was okay with a past lover hanging around? Something to be said for a little self-confidence, I suppose. And probably for it not being his best friend again.
Yeah. You do what you have to do with this situation. And if you slip up and, I don't know, kiss this ghost, is that even possible?
I shrugged.
Do your best and just, you know, don't give me minute-by-minute updates on everything that happens. Better yet, don't tell me any of it. I'm happier not knowing. But if you decide you want him instead, please, just be honest with me.
What? I laughed before I could stop myself. I don't think I understand.
I'm saying what I don't know can't hurt me. But please don't try to have us both. I'm not sharing you, period. At the same time, I know you're not perfect. And from what I've heard, it's easy to relapse with someone you used to love. Does that make sense?
Sort of. I squinted at him. It almost sounds like you're trusting me to handle my business. He chuckled.
Yeah, I guess I am.
He squeezed my hand before letting go and returning to his salad.
Chalk it up to my being in way over my head with this new job. I'm already handling half the town's business for them.
And you don't have time to worry about me. He popped a crouton into his mouth.
Exactly. No offense.
None taken. I stared at him, baffled. I'd never had a man trust me like that.
It seemed like a bad idea, to be honest. I hardly trusted myself. But it also felt like a weight had been lifted. I had breathing room. If I slipped up and kissed Roland, presumably in my sleep, or if he followed me to the in-between plane where I could physically interact with spirits, I could simply stop kissing him whenever my head returned to me, and I wouldn't have to carry the guilt of having made that mistake. A rogue piece of lettuce flapped out of Tanner's mouth, splashing dressing onto his face. It was hard to rectify the man sitting across from me with Caesar dressing across his cheek as he battled a leafy green with the profound gifts he'd just given me. Trust and forgiveness. More than that, his forgiveness had granted me permission to start forgiving myself. The thought made me itch. What was that like? I had to ask it. Is this like some weird thing that you're going through because you're 29? He looked up. Huh? Yeah, I read about this once. When people are an age that ends in 9 and staring down a new decade of life, they reevaluate everything and make major changes. He laughed. If you don't like it, I can be jealous of the fact that some lover from the past is trying to win back my girlfriend and she hasn't put a stop to it. I'll do anything you ask, Nora. Even if it's being a jerk. He arched a brow at me. No, no, I said, backtracking. I like this version of you. I liked the old one, but for obvious reasons, this one works out better for me. As long as you mean what you say, I'll consider myself even luckier than I realized and attribute it to the winds of change. He groaned. Don't get me started on those. I know, I know. The stories had been rolling in from all directions for the last few weeks since the first winds had swept through Eastwind. The effects so far, according to Ted, were relatively mild. A few younger witches had hit an early puberty. A handful of Eastwinders had suddenly decided to sell off their property and move to another realm, and the number of people dyeing their hair a new color was at a record high. And all the while, the tensions between witches and wares simmered on. Tanner had gotten the worst of everyone's strange behavior, being the one to mediate the petty spats between long-term neighbors and friends. You know Veronica Lovelace put a sign on her front gate that says, "All witches entering the premises will be eaten," he said. I've had to go up to Hightower Gardens 3 times this week to run off witches who were loitering outside her gates just to agitate her. Don't they have better things to do? Did she let you onto her property without trying to eat you? He rolled his eyes. Of course. She makes an exception for the help. Also, she happens to like you for sneaking her deliveries from medium rare when we thought someone was poisoning her food with silver. She's not going to like me for long. I'm about to tell her to stop sending us emergency owls. Nora, Tanner, said a familiar female voice to my left. Nice to see you two enjoying a night out together. When my eyes found the speaker, I couldn't make sense of it. Why was she addressing us like we were old friends? Evening, Mayor, said Tanner. There was a civility to his tone, but no sign of warmness. Mayor Asperia nodded at him. Nora, I've been meaning to check in with you. See how your lessons with Oliver are going. Fine, I said. What was her angle? No way she gave 2 lynx licks about my lessons. Also, she said, lowering her voice as her eyes scanned the surrounding tables, I never thanked you personally for what you did for Grace. And you too, Tanner. I understand I also owe a debt of gratitude to Landon, Ava, and Donovan as well, she beamed. You really don't, said Tanner, because we didn't do it for you. We did it for Grace. I snapped my head around to stare at him, wide-eyed. Did he really just mouth off to the mayor? When I looked back at Asperia, she seemed equally as off balance. Of course. It's just that we narrowly avoided a real mess, you know. What with 3 coven members trying to frame a werewolf for murder. I shudder to think where that could have led in this community. However, The fact that it was witches who cleaned up the mess helps quite a bit. It shows the rest of the town that the witch community holds itself to high standards of accountability, and that when something happens, we take care of it. We don't try to cover it up. Tanner nodded.
With all due respect, Mayor, the fact that we're witches might have helped us get to the bottom of it. But I believe everyone there that night would have done the same thing, regardless of what creatures we were, and regardless of what creatures Hunter, Annabelle, and Jackie were. It's not about species for us. It's about right and wrong.
This time when the mayor smiled, it held much less mirth.
Well, yes, you're certainly free to believe that.
All the same, that show of witchly responsibility has turned a situation that could have derailed the promotion of important legislation into a gain for the cause.
The Werewolf Protection Act, I said.
That's what you're talking about? She nodded. Yes, but we're thinking of expanding it now. Werewolves aren't the only threat to the peaceful existence of witches in Eastwind.
Tanner laughed. You're right. In the case of Grace Merriweather, it was actually witches who presented the threat. Seriously, Mayor Asperia, you should come out with me on the job one night. You'll see what's really going on in this town. Now, if you'll excuse us, we're trying to have a date night.
He motioned to the spread on our table. I couldn't take my eyes off Tanner, not even to see whether the mayor was ready to throttle him. From the corner of my eye, I watched her leave. Still, my gaze was locked onto him.
You just told off the mayor. He rolled his shoulders back. Did I?
But there was that half grin.
I guess I'm just sick of everyone blaming everyone else for their trouble.
You've only been working this job for a month, and you're already jaded? He nodded.
Yep. I gotta tell you, I understand Stu Manchester a whole lot better now. Considering how many years he's been at this, it's a wonder he isn't crabbier than Ruby when she's missed her morning tea.
Don't take this the wrong way, I said, but I think the jadedness suits you. He grinned hungrily at me, and not just because there was no way a grilled chicken Caesar salad was enough food for him. But then his grin went slack, and his eyes grew wide as he stared at something over my shoulder. I turned to see what it was, and when I spotted it, his reaction instantly made sense. Chapter 2. Liberty Freeman entered the restaurant, and just ahead of him walked one of the most beautiful women I'd ever seen. Tandy Erickson, the Barbie-like Shenna who'd murdered Bruce Saxon, didn't hold a candle to this woman. "Who is that?" I breathed. Tanner was too dumbstruck to respond, and I wasn't even mad. I couldn't stop ogling the woman either. She had thick black hair that spiraled in loose curls down her shoulders and back. Her skin was the color of toasted almonds. There was a passion in her dark eyes that made her thick lashes seem almost indecent, and every step she took was like smoke wafting on a gentle breeze. Her full hips swayed hypnotically until she paused and waited for Liberty to catch up. He put an arm around her shoulder, a smartly protective gesture, I thought, considering the way everyone was staring at her, and they approached the empty table the hostess had gestured to. Our table was along their path, and when Liberty's eyes landed on Tanner, he flashed that wide, white grin and nodded, diverting from his path to make a pit stop at our table.
"Hey, man," he said, shaking Tanner's hand.
"Hi,"
Tanner said hoarsely, his eyes locked onto the woman.
"Nora,"
Liberty said warmly, leaning over and wrapping me in a hug where I sat. He smelled different than usual. It was intoxicating and blurred my thoughts. Genie cologne? Was that a thing?
"How's it going?" I said as he released me.
The awkward angle of the hug had spared me his usual vice grip.
"Great."
He stepped to the side and presented his date.
"This is Emma Jean. Emma Jean, this is Nora and Tanner. They're good people. Tanner is a deputy, and Nora is a..."
He squinted at me. Do you prefer restaurant owner or Fifth Wind?
Either, I said.
A Fifth Wind, said Imogen. Her voice was deep and rich.
Really?
Yep.
She nodded approvingly.
Nice to know Eastwind has one of those. Where I come from, every Fifth Wind was rounded up and murdered hundreds of years ago.
I looked from Imogen to Liberty.
Where do you come from?
I'll be sure never to visit.
She's from Zatrian, said Liberty.
Isn't that where you were from? I asked, and he nodded.
Old friends?
Not exactly, said Imogen. Former enemies.
She laughed.
Things change, though. Not always for the best, but in this case, I'm very satisfied.
I'll take credit for that, said Liberty, wrapping an arm around her waist and pulling her close to his side.
Tanner was still unable to form words, probably more so now with his proximity to Imogen, so I was in charge of small talk.
When'd you get into town?
Just today, she said.
Staying long?
She gazed up at Liberty.
As long as he's willing to keep me around.
Liberty, it seemed, wasn't immune to her looks and presence either. I was tempted to suggest they forego dinner and head straight to whatever private destination they had planned.
Baby, Liberty said, gazing down at her. You may not be a slave anymore, but I plan on keeping you here as long as I can.
Oh, I said, trying to cut through the sexual tension so we didn't have some sort of powerful, magical PDA situation on our hands.
Are you a genie as well?
That did the trick, thankfully. Imogen turned away from Liberty to respond.
Yes, we'll see how long it takes before they try to run me out of town. From what I've heard, one genie is one too many for most Eastwinders.
Huh? I said. Everyone loves Liberty.
Nuh-uh, he said. Some people love me, and the rest are scared not to love me. There's a difference. Doesn't matter, though. They might not like Imogen here, but who's going to have the guts to make her leave?
Not me, Tanner said, finally breaking the silence.
I think she should stay for as long as she wants.
Liberty laughed.
I bet you do, Culpepper. Well, we better let you two finish your meal. See you around?
Yes, please, Tanner mumbled as the genies left.
I reached across the table and snapped to get his attention.
Hey, show's over.
He blinked a few times and seemed to remember where he was.
Right. I'd better get going. You got the check, right?
I rolled my eyes, but not because of the money. I was the richer of the two now that he'd chosen a life in public service and had taken a hit on his earnings from the diner. Your shift doesn't start for another hour. Come on and finish your dinner. He grimaced, then relented.
Okay, fine.
He leaned forward so as not to be overheard.
It's just that I still get a little anxious before a shift. Now that I've switched to nights, it takes a good 10 minutes to psych myself up before I send Stu home.
That means 10 minutes to psych yourself up, 10 minutes to walk to your place to grab your uniform, and 5 minutes from your house to the sheriff's office. By my calculation, that still leaves you 25 minutes to hang out and enjoy your meal.
Or, he said, 5 minutes to enjoy my meal, and 20 minutes to enjoy something else.
Sly smile lines appeared around his eyes. I reached in my pocket, pulled out way too many coins, and tossed them on the table before standing. Make it 24 minutes to enjoy something else.
Now we're talking.
He shoveled as much salad as he could fit into his mouth, then jumped up and grabbed my hand, dragging me out of Stews and Brews without looking back. Chapter 3.
Always, Nora, he whispered. There's no woman but you for me.
He brushed the hair back from my shoulder as he brushed kisses down my neck.
Anything you want, I'll give it to you. Anything at all.
I knew what I wanted. It wasn't complicated. A small voice in my head nagged at me that I shouldn't want it from him, though. I couldn't pinpoint why that might be. The wind howled against the window of this large and expensively furnished bedroom as he pressed me to the door. I didn't fight him. Memories began to return to me in flashes. The two of us riding horses across endless green fields in a hurry to get as far from everyone we knew as possible. Everyone except each other. The time his neighbors berated me for being poor and he stepped in, appearing almost out of nowhere to stand up for me, and the way he held me afterward and assured me there was nothing wrong with who I was. One after the next, the memories rushed into my bloodstream, and I knew he meant what he said. You know what I want, Roland.
I do.
His breath on my neck made me shiver.
But I need to hear you say the words. I need to be sure this isn't another false alarm. Because once we cross this line, Diana, I won't be able to hold back any longer.
I swallowed hard. The words were right there on my tongue, and I imagined what would come next. He'd carry me over to his four-poster and buttons would go flying in our frantic scramble, driven by hundreds of years of separation. The passion inside me was more than I knew a body could contain. I opened my mouth, summoning up the words, trying to find the right ones, the ones that had been locked away inside me for so long. Yes, I snapped awake to the sound of a deep bark. Pushing myself up in bed, I squinted through the dark bedroom in Ruby True's house as two realities swirled together in my head. On his doggy bed in the corner, Grim lay on his side, running in place and barking in his sleep. For Fang's sake, I moaned, running a hand over my face. My heart raced and my skin tingled all over. Where had that dream come from? I thought my previous dreams with Roland had been realistic, but none held a candle to what had just happened. This was something new, something more powerful than a simple dream. And goddess help me, in that moment, I wanted more. I flopped onto my back and shut my eyes, trying to steady my breathing.
"You're remembering," he said.
I pushed up onto my elbows quickly. Roland beamed at me from his spot at the end of my bed.
"I am. There's so much more to remember, my love. Why don't you go back to sleep and we can pick up where we left off?"
Yeah, why didn't I? There was probably a reason, even if my groggy mind was unable to pinpoint it. Oh, right. Tanner. The guilt hit before I remembered what he'd said earlier that night. If I slipped up, I should forgive myself, so long as I still chose him. And I did. I still chose Tanner. I don't know if it's a good idea to remember.
Be that as it may, it will feel good to remember.
Sweet baby jackalope. Every second I managed to resist Roland O'Neill's sculpted jaw and plump lips should have earned me a freaking award. No.
Ah, he said, not at all deterred. Suit yourself. But you have to go to sleep sometime.
That devilish grin. Good golem. It was like I'd never before realized just how dead sexy it was. But now I did. Stay out of my dreams, I barked.
Stop inviting me into them.
I didn't invite you in.
Keep it down, you two. I was just having the most amazing dream about this hillcat I used to hunt. I almost had her this time. But you did invite me in, Roland said. Dreams don't call out with the voice, love. They call out with the heart. And yours is calling out to mine.
I groaned. Can't you just refuse the call?
Never have. Never will.
I thought you said you'd do anything for me. He nodded.
I will. But I'd be doing that for Tanner, not for you.
I flopped back down again, staring up at the ceiling and willing my eyes to stay open. Of course, I couldn't stay awake forever, but if I could just make it through this especially trying night, I might have more resolve tomorrow. I had to push through. I didn't understand why tonight was different. Probably just hormones, but maybe it was just a one-time thing I could conquer. At some point, I lost the battle.
I knew you'd be back,
he said. We were on his bed now, still fully clothed, thankfully. We would have crossed into some iffy territory consent-wise if I'd found myself undressed without remembering it. His legs ran alongside mine as he braced himself above me. I stared into his eyes, those beautiful turquoise gems that I'd found comfort in so many times.
Ah, he said softly. There you are, Diana. I can always tell when you return.
His lips met mine, and I was toast. I reached up, wrapping my arms around his shoulders, pulling him against me, savoring the weight of his body on mine. I slipped my hands between us, unbuttoning the top few buttons of his shirt, before growing frustrated with the slow progress and taking hold of each side, yanking it open as hard as I could. I heard the snapping of threads, and with it, the snapping of any self-control I had left. A knock on the door snapped me awake again. Son of a banshee, I said, sitting up in bed with a start. It wasn't Roland's bedroom door, or even my own where the sound originated, though. I pressed my palms into my eyes to try to get my bearings. When I removed them, Roland was nowhere to be seen, which was a small victory. I glanced at Grimm, also awake.
Was that 3 times? Or 4 times,
my familiar asked. I replayed it in my memory. I think it was 5 times.
Uh-oh.
What? What does 5 knocks mean?
It means whoever it is has their mind set on being heard, and I won't be able to go back to sleep until it's dealt with.
Who knows? Maybe they'll go away. I waited, listening through the darkness. Yes, it was good that I'd been woken up when I had, but that didn't stop me from being incredibly annoyed. Sounds like they wanna... Knock, 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 knock.
They're even more impatient now, Grimm said.
What do you think the odds are that Ruby gets it instead?
Probably the same odds as her answering it and then chewing you out for not getting it first.
I swung my feet around and shuffled downstairs, Grimm following behind me, likely out of morbid curiosity rather than any altruistic impulse. Whoever was on the porch was in the middle of another burst of knocks when I flung open the door and squinted out into the night. Jane? Ansel? What's wrong? Each had arms crossed over their chest, annoyance twisting down the corners of their lips. We need your help, Jane said. Of course, I said, still trying to figure out what would cause my best friend and her husband to show up like this in the middle of the night. What can I do? Can you see them? She asked. See who? Both Jane and Ansel looked back over their shoulders, and as they did, I noticed the floating figures behind them, glowing like soft moonlight.
Siren's song. Grimm said from behind me. There are 2 faces I never wanted to see again. Hi, Nora, said the ghost of Bruce Saxon. Sorry to bother you.
Same here, said Heather Lovelace. I really don't see any reason to bring you into this. Didn't see the reason? I couldn't see a way the return of 2 supposedly at-peace spirits could avoid dragging the town's only working fifth wind into it. I opened the door wide. Why don't the 4 of you come inside? Chapter 4. Does it usually take this long? Jane asked impatiently. I finished the anchoring spell for Bruce and shot her a glare that I might not have risked had it been later than 2:45 in the morning when my survival instincts were firing on all cylinders. There. Done. You know magic takes a bit, I said. Her arms remained crossed tightly over her chest. I thought the whole point of it was so things don't take as long. Ansel stood a few feet to his wife's side, not saying a word and looking more sheepish than usual. I addressed him. Any idea why Heather Lovelace is haunting you two? A split-second surprise darkened his face like a cloud passing in front of a full moon.
Is that who it is?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.